Do you ever have a hard time picking what to eat? Whenever I go to a restaurant, I always have a hard time choosing between all the different menu options. Each of them, of course, are designed to sound as appealing and delicious as possible. So when I go to decide, I always have to weigh the different options. I think about the cost of the different dishes. I might think about the nutritional value, especially if you have any dietary restrictions. I might think about what flavors I might be interested in for that particular evening. If I'm eating with somebody else, I might ask them for some input just so I can have some other opinion there to help make my decision. These are regular decisions that we make, often on a daily basis. Now, when we think about it, our molecules have to make similar decisions in order to choose between the different menu of reaction options that they have open to them. So our alkyl halides and alcohols, for example, we know can undergo both substitution and elimination reactions in very similar conditions. So if we have an alkyl halide combined with a nucleophile or a base, we know that it can attack directly and kick off our base in a substitution reaction. But it could also potentially attack our beta hydrogen over here and eliminate as we break off our leaving group in an elimination reaction. In addition to these main routes of substitution and elimination, we of course also have our individual mechanisms of our SN1 and SN2 reactions, as well as our E1 and E2 reaction pathways. So essentially, our alcohols and our alkyl halides have four different menu options, and they're going to need to use different factors to choose between these different options. In the case of our alcohols and alkyl halides, it'll be using factors like solvent, or the structure of our alkyl halide or alcohol, or the strength of our nucleophile or base, right? So it's making a similar decision as the decisions that we make, but it's using more molecular-based factors in order to reach that decision. So the first factor that we'll look at for choosing between our menu of reactions is going to be the solvent that we're using. Now, of course, we've looked at this previously, specifically for SN1 and SN2 reactions, and what we saw was that our SN1 reactions preferred polar and protic solvents. So these polar protic solvents, they tend to be highly polar, and they're able to interact with our carbocation and help to stabilize that and then allow our SN1 reaction to proceed more quickly. Now, of course, our E1 reaction would have a similar carbocation intermediate, so we might expect that polar protic solvents are also useful for our E1 reaction. Right, so it have the same kind of role, it's stabilizing our carbocation and allowing that reaction to occur more quickly. Now for SN2, of course, what we saw was that we didn't like that protic solvent, right? So here we preferred a polar aprotic solvent. Again, of course, an aprotic solvent would be a solvent that doesn't have a hydrogen that can be used for hydrogen bonding, right? So a hydrogen attached to an electronegative oxygen or nitrogen. And the reason why that SN2 preferred an aprotic solvent is because that aprotic solvent doesn't have as strong of interactions with the nucleophile that we would be using in our SN2 reaction. And so it's not going to see any interference from that solvent blocking our nucleophile from attacking our alkyl halide or alcohol. So we might expect then that our E2 reaction would be similar, where it would have a preference for polar aprotic solvents. But remember, our E2 reaction isn't quite as dependent on this nucleophile attacking here and knocking off our leaving group, right? It's just reacting as a base, so it's not as affected by things like the crowding of our structure overall, or even the crowding of our nucleophile by the solvent. So it really doesn't have as much of a strong dependency on that aprotic solvent. So our E2 is actually somewhat less selective here, and we're not just going to be able to use the solvent in order to select between our E1 and E2 reactions. So again, this is going to prefer polar solvents, right, because we're going to need something that's going to be able to stabilize our base, right? Our base is usually going to be negatively charged, and so we need to dissolve that base in our solvent. But it's not really going to have that same strong preference for protic or aprotic. So overall, our solvent will allow us to choose between SN1 and SN2 reactions, but it doesn't necessarily allow us to choose between substitution versus elimination. So we're going to need to consider some other factors here. The next key factor that we're going to use for choosing between our menu of different reaction options is the crowding and or the substitution pattern of our reactants. Now, of course, you've already looked at this to some extent for different reactions, but here we're going to compare them all together and see what kind of overall patterns we see for all four reactions. So first off, with our SN1 reaction, we do want to see a highly substituted reactant. Right, so we want something that's tertiary, ideally. So that would lead to our tertiary carbocation, which is, of course, our more stable carbocation that allows our SN1 reaction to proceed more quickly. We also see secondary reactants to some extent, although these will be, of course, slower in our SN1 reactions, and they won't have as high of a preference for SN1. Primary methyl are very rare in SN1 because you don't have stable carbocations there. For our SN2 reactions, we of course have the opposite trend. We're going to prefer methyl-based reactants or primary reactants, right, where we have very uncrowded reaction sites. Our nucleophile can come in and attack without that crowding blocking our reaction. We do see some secondary reactions, but again, they're going to be very unlikely, or less likely rather, because of the crowding there blocking our reaction. Overall, of course, we need our molecule to be uncrowded. Both our nucleophile as well as our nearby carbons. So this is because, again, that crowding, so even if it's at an adjacent site, it can still kind of block our nucleophile from coming in. We can even have crowding up here, right? So if we add a few extra carbons onto our nucleophile, that can make our nucleophile too crowded to attack in here as well. So it's really strongly affected by crowding. It needs stuff that have limited crowding on our at our leaving group, as well as limited crowding on our nucleophile and nearby carbons. For our elimination reactions, we see less effect of our crowding, right? So they're not so much concerned by crowding, although they do still have the crowding effects and the substitution effects based on the stability of the intermediates and the final product. So our E1 reaction, again, is going to prefer tertiary and secondary reactants. This is because we do have our carbocation intermediate, right? So we have to keep that carbocation intermediate stabilized. Whereas our E2 reactions have no carbocation intermediate. So we can potentially see reactions with primary reactants, right? So we still have the same preference based on the stability of our alkene product. But it's not as important overall, right? So we don't have that carbocation intermediate here that requires that stabilization of our intermediate. Our last key factor that we need to consider is the basicity or the nucleophilicity of our reactant. Now, of course, remember in our substitution versus elimination reactions. So we need a good nucleophile for our substitution, but for our elimination, we need a good base. Right, so we're attacking and forming a new bond between our nucleophile and our alkyl halide or alcohol, versus in elimination, we're just pulling off a hydrogen and reacting purely as a base. Now, basicity and nucleophilicity are similar, right? So many compounds are both strong nucleophiles and strong bases, but they aren't exactly the same. So we will have some compounds that will be stronger bases and weaker nucleophiles, or stronger nucleophiles and weaker bases. So if we have a strong nucleophile, that of course will prefer our substitution reactions. So our reactant then is going to attack directly and break off that leaving group in our substitution reaction. Now of course I wrote that here in our SN2 reaction because our SN2 reaction again is more dependent on the nucleophile compared to our SN1 reaction. An SN1 reaction, our rate limiting step doesn't even involve a nucleophile, right? The leaving group breaks off to form our carbocation, that's our slow step, and the nucleophile attacks afterwards to get our final product. So even though we still are using that nucleophile in our SN1 reaction, we're actually not as dependent on that. So SN1 reactions actually tend to happen more with weak nucleophiles, where our nucleophile is not as eager to attack, right? If we have a nucleophile that's very eager to attack, it just wants to attack directly and get it over with without waiting for that carbocation to form first. Now for E2 reactions, of course, they're reacting as a base, so here we need a very strong base. So we're going to go with a strong base, and we're going to pull off that hydrogen again since we're more basic, and use that to react through our elimination pathway. We can also say that our SN2 reactions prefer weaker bases, right? So they want a weaker base because if we have a strong base there, then we're more likely to see elimination. We can say the same thing over here for our elimination reactions. They prefer weak nucleophiles because if we have too strong of a nucleophile, then we'd be more likely to see our SN2 reaction. Finally, for our E1 reaction, here again we see we want more of a weak base or a weak nucleophile because if we're strong, we're just going to go and react directly in our E2 reaction, right? There's no reason to use that mechanism that creates our unstable intermediate if we can just directly use the mechanism that avoids that unstable intermediate. So we're more likely to see this with weak base. And we could also have weak nucleophiles here as well. And of course, we could add that in for our SN1 reaction as well. So here we would expect to see weak bases, because if we have a strong base, we would tend to see that E2 reaction. Some good examples here. So for strong nucleophiles and weak bases, these would be things like our halides, right? So you might remember from earlier in the semester that halides, our hydrogen halides tend to be very strong acids. That means their conjugate bases, the halide ions, tend to be very weak bases. However, they still have lots of electron density, meaning that they do make very good nucleophiles. So halides are very good for our substitution reactions. Things like thiolates. So a thiolate would be a sulfur-based molecule with a negative charge. These make for very good nucleophiles, but weaker bases. Again, similar properties where they have that weak bond to our hydrogen that makes them stronger acids and therefore weaker conjugate bases. With our E2 reactions, our strong bases tend to be things like our alkoxides, right? Alkoxides, we have that negatively charged oxygen that acts as a very great base, similar to our sodium hydroxide. So that will happily pull off our hydrogens in these elimination reactions. So now that we've looked at the different factors that play a role in choosing between our different reactions, we need to put these all together and decide how can we actually select for our reaction combining our three different factors. So the first thing I always recommend to look at is the crowding or the substitution pattern of our reactants. So if we have something that's very uncrowded, a methyl or a primary substituent, that's when we're likely to see a SN2 reaction. Again, of course, also we need to have an uncrowded nucleophile, and it needs to be uncrowded near our reactant site, but under these conditions, SN2 will be preferred. If we have anything that's secondary or tertiary or primary but has other crowding, then we're going to have to choose between our different elimination reactions or SN1 reaction. So the second factor that we usually want to consider is our basicity and or our nucleophilicity. So if we have strong bases, we're going to tend to prefer our E2 reactions. So if there's any amount of crowding at all and we have a strong base, we'll tend to see E2, right? It can even occur if we have primary reactants, as long as we have that beta hydrogen nearby that we can eliminate to make our alkene double bond. For our SN2 reactions, we'll tend to want, again, strong nucleophiles but weaker bases. So if we have a weak base, but we still have a strong nucleophile, we'll tend to see SN2, right? Because we aren't going to have that base available to pull off our hydrogen in our elimination reaction. Finally, the SN1 and the E1 reactions really only occur for weaker bases and weaker nucleophiles, right? They're kind of less common overall. So we're choosing first between SN2 versus E2, and then if neither of those are possible, because we have weak base, weak nucleophile, and or crowding, then we're going to be looking at our SN1 and E1 reactions. Now our third factor, of course, is the solvent. The solvent can help to tell between SN1 and SN2 reactions. It's less useful for elimination reactions. Generally, it's not going to have as large of an impact on selecting our reaction options as our crowding and our basicity or nucleophilicity. Now you might notice here that so far none of the factors that we've really considered select clearly between SN1 and E1 reactions. So this is because in most cases we'll actually have E1 and SN1 reactions happening at the same time. So these aren't as selective, right? They prefer kind of similar conditions with weak bases, weak nucleophiles, and are more substituted reactants. So it's going to be pretty difficult to distinguish between these two reactions. They'll both tend to happen at the same time. The one scenario where we will tend to see SN1 reactions is if we have a relatively strong nucleophile and weak base, but we're too crowded to have an SN2 reaction, right? So we do get some preference here for strong nucleophiles as well, assuming that we don't have a scenario with respect to crowding where we can see that SN2 reaction. So as we can see, our organic molecules are actually evaluating these different key factors in order to choose what reaction they want to perform. This is something that we can do as well, right? We can analyze the different factors that might be affecting our system, and we can predict what reaction is going to occur as well, right? So that's very important. If we want to synthesize a particular compound, we need to know for sure what reaction is going to take place to know what product we can form. So this is something, of course, that we do very commonly in lab, right? We might change what nucleophile or base we're using or change what solvent we're using in order to help ensure that we have the correct product forming. So it's very important to be able to know what reactions are likely to occur under what reaction conditions.